This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
On the last episode of Starship, Sabers, and Scoundrels, we broke through ceilings, walls, and floors, all made of melted sand.
So our discussion of The Last Jedi is concluding this week with a look at some of the key figures of the Resistance. More specifically, we're examining the roles of General Organa, Poe Dameron, and Vice Admiral Holdo. Mm-hmm.
Wasn't there autopilot on any of those ships?
Can you set a ship to go auto to hyperspace, though? I mean,
I don't know.
Right. So I'm putting you two on the spot right now. So Taxus, if you could have a dark side hero, and I would say keep it out of the weeds, try and think of a bit more mainstream here. Who would you like to see added?
You know what? I'm going to take General Veers.
General Veers?
Yeah. No, I mean, okay. Officers are important.
Seriously?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay. You know?
When he arrives on Canto Bight, the authorities invite him to park on the beach. He once won a Fathia race while riding a Bantha. He doesn't need to pick the locks to the Canto Bight City Jail. He just comes and goes as he pleases. When the Supremacy attacked his transports, he went to hyperspace and came back with tacos. He interrupted the Battle of Crait to get salt for his tequila. His use of force time has resulted in 2 restraining orders. He is the only one that gets away with calling Armitage General Hugs. He is the most interesting Sith in the galaxy.
I always drink. And sometimes, when I'm desperate, I drink Dulce She's Beer. Stay seated, my fools.
Well, and I want to preface this by saying, don't read anything into this except for what we have seen ourselves.
We are back, and the road to Solo starts now. Here's what is in store on this week's show. The drought is over. Lucasfilm has finally given us our first glimpses at Solo, A Star Wars Story. We'll discuss the trailer, TV spot, and more in this week's news. Jay has more lifestyle product and fashion news in the latest edition of That's So Wizard. Every good scoundrel knows to always look over their shoulder because you never know when a bounty hunter might be in pursuit. We discuss the likes of Boba Fett and Cad Bane and this week's hypothetical. Last episode, we asked which dark side characters we wanted to see in Battlefront 2. This week, we discussed the results of our Twitter poll asking the same question and silence fools. I thought we were in trouble there for a second, but it's fine. We're fine. Thanks for joining us for episode 48 of Starships, Sabers, and Scoundrels.
I really hate Valentine's Day.
Why is that?
I can't handle the pressure.
What do you mean?
Oh, you know what I mean. I'm pressured to find the right way to say how I feel. And last year, I kind of raised the bar way too high.
So what'd you get the Lady Taxus?
I went all out with a card I found at a car wash gift shop. It had a dog holding a bone covered in dirt. It said, "I really dig you." I felt it was the best way to say, "I appreciate your tolerance of me all these years. Let us continue our partnership together."
How romantic.
Yeah, so how did you two meet in the first place?
Well, that's a great story. You see, I posted a profile on different dating sites. You know, Hater, Hinder, Unharmony, SithLordsOnly.com. I went through bad date after bad date. I mean, I even went out on a date where she expected me to pay. But all of those were a waste of money because she found me. At first, I tried to keep her at a distance, but she kept pursuing me.
Until love won you over?
No. I ran out of fuel for my ship.
And so what? She came to your aid?
No. She was a bounty hunter. At least she waited for me on the outside.
Happy contractually agreed upon exchange of affections, scoundrels. You've come back to the podcast that thinks the best way you say you care is by making a black and white glossy photographed with a telescopic lens of the object of your affection and mailing it to them with their face circled with a red marker and the word soon written underneath. I'm your co-host and secret admirer of Dark Intentions,
Darth Taxus,
coming to you from the chocolate shop of my flagship, the Assessor Collector. And with me are your other co-hosts who think the best way to say, "I know," is with flowers.
Dennis, the Phantom Menace Keithley, and Jay, the Hutt Jair Krebs. Dennis and Jay.
Okay, that was really creepy until you started talking about chocolate. And then it was all okay. So yeah. Hey, guys.
So we have a big show coming up because, wow, did they dump a whole bunch of Solo news on us. And it's perfect timing because this episode was our planned beginning of the road to Solo. So fantastic. So we'll be getting a lot of that stuff in our news. Just as a reminder to our scoundrels, we, as part of the road to Solo, we are going through Brian Daly's Solo trilogy. And that's from back at the end of the 70s is when this came out. And our first book will be Han Solo at Star's End. And we are going to review that on the show that comes out on February 27th. So you still have a couple weeks to read that if you want to just kind of follow along with our Scoundrels book club this time around. And before we get into the meat of the show, I just wanted to touch real quick on an experience that I got to have. The Allen Americans, the local ECHL hockey team, had a Star Wars night a couple weeks ago.
Very cool.
By pure coincidence, I just happened to have tickets to that game. And it was coincidence. We had no idea it was Star Wars night when we bought them. But
it was the Force.
Definitely. But it was a lot of fun. The 501st was there. So I got to take my picture with some of them, got pictures with my kids with them. The Order 66 Toys, which is a toy shop devoted to Star Wars, had a huge booth set up there with tons of action figures.
Dickie Beer was there.
Yeah, he dropped the puck to, at the beginning of the game. So it was a lot of fun. There was a lot of impressive costumes by the 501st. The Darth Vader was a little short, but did a great job.
Aren't you a little short for Lord Darth Vader?
A bunch of the stormtroopers were wandering around with the their pauldrons had the Texas flag painted on them. Which
cool.
I remembered the Alamo.
Wasn't sure it quite lived up to the official thing, but it was still fun.
Yeah.
And then there was the I had never seen one of these before, but it doesn't seem like a complicated costume, but it was pulled off extremely well. But someone was dressed up as Padme in her snowsuit from the Clone Wars micro series.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, and she did a really great job. You know, she had the white cat suit on underneath, and then the fur cloak, fur-trimmed cloak over that, and then the blaster, which was a really nice touch. So,
cool.
Yeah, they had, I guess the Rebel Garrison Rebel Legion was out there as well. And, so they had a few members. There were some various Jedi wandering around, but it was a good time. So it's just a long way of saying, if these Star Wars nights, and they seem to happen everywhere with the top tier teams in the NFL, not so much them, but the NHL, NBA, and baseball does them. And a lot of the minor league teams do them. I highly recommend going out and checking it out. It was a lot of fun. My kids really enjoyed it. The Allen Americans wore Boba Fett themed jerseys for the game.
Yeah, and they were selling those too, right?
Not so much at the game. I think you could get them online, but I didn't, because they had a sample one up in the store, but they didn't have them available for purchase there.
That's cool. Why do you think they picked Boba Fett? I mean, it's kind of close to the colors.
I'm not sure that's correct.
No, not really. The Allen Americans wear red for the most part. It's okay. There were some fans wearing the Star Wars night jerseys from prior seasons, and I think it was just something different that they hadn't done yet. One of them had I think it was Darth Vader fighting Luke on it. They just had a kind of a painting type of a feel. So it was something different that they hadn't done yet.
And that would have been awesome if like all their hockey sticks lit up like lightsabers.
Well, you say that, but they were auctioning off at a silent auction, a lightsaber hockey stick. So,
whoa,
but the bid was, I think, something like $300 or $400 by the time I got there. So I passed,
gosh.
A little steep. Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But, they were auctioning off a stormtrooper helmet. They had that and various other things.
You know what? Hockey is such a great medium. I just realized for Star Wars stick, you know, did you see a lot of people out there in the audience? I mean, that were wearing, at least representing, I mean, like, were they wearing at least Star Wars shirts? Were there people cosplaying besides Leia you saw, or I'm sorry, the Padme you saw?
Well, yeah, that she was there with the 501st or the Rebel Legion, but there were most fans were wearing t-shirts or sweatshirts. It's cold in the hockey arena there. Mm-hmm. A lot of them were wearing Star Wars themed. They were handing out inflatable lightsabers to all the kids.
Oh, awesome.
They had red and blue ones. There was a lot of kids that were dressed up as Leia or Darth Vader or, you know, they Halloween costumes, essentially. There was a few adults that came and cosplay, but it was much more along the lines of t-shirts and sweatshirts. And it's the Island Americans. I've been to a lot of games over the past several years because it is a real family friendly, more affordable version of going to a hockey game as compared to say the NHL.
Yeah.
And a typical game is one third to one half full. So a couple thousand people, this was a full house for this game. And a lot. And the fans that come regularly are fairly devoted and they have a lot of Allen Americans gear. And so a lot of them were wearing that. And then, but you know, the scoreboard had the Rebel logo up for the Allen Americans and the Imperial logo up for them, which is
yeah.
You know, they played Star Wars music when the teams came out on the ice. That's great. Really got into the theme. It was not, nothing was spared for it. They really put a lot of effort into it.
So did the other team wear jerseys, some sort of Star Wars jerseys? Like that?
No, they just wore their regular. Thunder just wore their regular.
What, you know what would have been great is if they wore jerseys of Han Solo and Carbonite.
I don't think they were going to go for that, but I like where your head's at. Okay, well, thanks for indulging me on my report of Star Wars Night with the Allen Americans. Let's head on over to the news. There's plenty of Star Wars news this week, and most of it revolves around the Solo movie. Jay, please get us started.
And get us started, I will. The Solo promotions began with a big game TV spot that aired during a commercial break in the Super Bowl. At about 30 seconds long, the teaser featured images of a young Han Solo, Lando, Emilia Clarke, and Woody Harrelson, and of course, the Millennium Falcon. It ended with the promise that a full trailer would debut the next day. Yee! And I actually almost missed it. I was messing around on my phone, and my son goes, "Mom, you're missing something Star Wars right now on television." I'm like, "Oh, what is it, like Battlefront 2? I look up, I'm like, "Oh, wait. Rewind that. Hurry."
I was in denial that they were actually going to do this during the Super Bowl. In my opinion, Star Wars does not need to advertise. It's like the one property that does not actually benefit too much from being in front of this during, you know, on a commercial during the Super Bowl, because everyone's going to watch that trailer dozens of times on YouTube and elsewhere anyway. That being said, when it came on, I was surprised that A, it was as early in the Super Bowl as it was. And when it aired, I've been saying all along that I'm not really concerned about this movie. I've placed a lot of trust in Ron Howard, but I noticed that I had this huge exhale when it was over. And then I immediately shouted, "Yes!" I loved it. I absolutely loved this. Taxus, what was your favorite thing that you saw during that trailer?
You know, wow. Yeah, I gotta say that my favorite thing was the Twi'leks dancing.
I knew it.
Yeah. But other than that, okay. I really loved seeing the car speeder chase. Okay.
Yes.
And to me, like that one speeder, I think Han's driving it, but
yes,
it looks like a giant old 1950s Buick or something, you know, the way they designed the body and the windshield. And that kind of makes sense to me because, you know, hey, if it's like a car chase or something, you know, and you know, look who's directing it, you know, maybe this was a reshot scene, who knows, maybe it was originally in there, but it kind of gave me that feel like, you know, a Grease Lightning, you know what I mean?
Sure.
So something like that. But I, you know, okay, I've been on record saying, you know, why are you playing with my Han, my beloved Han, who's my favorite good guy character, you know? And although, you know, yeah, Alden Ehrenreich, you know, well, he's not quite a clone, I found myself, little scoundrel, saying, I'm good with this. I feel great about seeing this, you know? I feel like he's going to pull it off. And I feel like this is going to be a fun movie, you know, and that's what we need. We just need, I want a brainless Star Wars fun movie, you know. We just went through all that with The Last Jedi, right? And there's so much to it that's way deeper than on the surface, okay? I need fun. You know what I mean? I need to go to the Star Wars movie and I need to sit there and go, oh yeah, that's great. Did you see Han and Chewie doing that? What? You know? And that's what I want. I you know, it doesn't have to be deep and connective and super analytical. I just want a good Star Wars story. And I feel like this is what we're going to get.
Yeah, we're not going to go too far into the details of this TV spot because at this point, by the time our listeners are hearing this, this show has been out for, you know, this teaser spot has been out for over a week. Quick, Jay, what was your favorite part of all this?
Oh, well, I felt like I was slapped in the face. You know, it was like, what did I just see? But probably the thing that stood out to me the most was how shiny the inside of the Falcon is.
Yeah.
And I know that that's been a big, big, big point on social media is like, what the heck did Han do to that thing? You know, when Linus says, what did you do to my ship?
Yeah, it still has that new Corellian leather smell. Yeah.
You know? But two, the little speeder chase I thought was pretty exciting because it makes you want to know more.
Absolutely. But,
yeah.
Yeah. For me, there was two things that stood out. One, the shot of the Star Destroyer and that cloudy environment with the TIE fighters coming out.
Oh yeah.
That mood that it set was just incredible. And, two, I really, all the characters, Amelia Clark's character, the droid that's featured in there with the sparks flying all around it, that seems to be tied to, Lando somehow. Hmm. And, even Woody Harrelson's character, they all look fantastic. So anyway, Taxus, why don't you get on to the next thing? Cause this conversation is going to spill over into that next news item.
Well, as if that wasn't enough, the next day we all woke up in America and saw this. A second trailer. True to their word, Lucasfilm did debut the full trailer on Good Morning America. Although it featured many of the same scenes from the big game spot, it omitted some and added others. One of the highlights of this trailer was the introduction of a masked character that appeared to be the film's villain. Mm-hmm. So, now, let me issue this before we talk about this, okay? A lot has been said about, well, how come we haven't seen a teaser? How come we haven't seen the teaser trailer? Trailer. I feel like if this was a normal year, we would have seen what we saw on The Big Game, maybe months or a couple months before we saw this on Good Morning America, you know? Because to me, this was more of a teaser trailer, right? It was just a minute and a half or so, whereas the teaser was about a minute, if I'm remembering off of seeing the time on my, cellular phone, right? So do you feel like that? Do you feel like they kind of were saying, well, we typically always do a teaser, then teaser trailer, so let's go ahead and film them, and then we'll just, you know, we're kind of short-timed here, so let's run them out real quick together, you know?
Well, look, we could get into a whole another discussion about why it is that they're rolling everything out the way they are. Solo was filmed under a lot of difficulties. As you just pointed out, it's not a normal Star Wars year. There's two movies within a 6-month period.
Sure.
They're trying to keep them separate, not have them step on each other's toes.
Yep.
And, you know, as we're going to discuss over the course of this news segment, they put on the full court press with promoting this movie this week. Mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of, you know, they got to start getting things out there and promoting it. They're in a crunch. You know, they're still editing this movie. Ron Howard put something out on Twitter, but I can't remember where he was flying from to, but he mentioned that he was headed back to the studio to finish editing. So the movie's not done. They just did some pickup shots, in January. But, you know, that being said, this was another amazing thing.
Yeah.
I'm just so thrilled with this, with the way Solo looks. I'm getting a real couple different vibes for this movie. One, as you were talking about, Taxus, the classic car race.
Yeah.
You know, 50s, 60s movie type of movie. to a Western type of a feel. There's a shot during this trailer where you get the shot is from behind Solo's waist and he's latching his blaster and the villains are arrayed in front of him.
Right.
Background. And then a bit of a samurai motif with the villain who's got a helmet on and looks something like a Sith crossed with a samurai crossed with maybe some sort of a Native American type of warrior with some of the stuff that he's got on his armor. Mm-hmm. And then even a heist film. There's a train in these two trailers that they appear to be hijacking, which I guess goes to the old Western feel again. So I don't know. They've really captured quite a vibe for this movie just from what I'm picking up from the two trailers.
Yeah, that actually reminded me of Gone in 60 Seconds. being in the car in the speeder. But I gotta say, I had a delay that morning for snow for school, so I didn't have to be at school right away. So I actually got to see it when it was aired, which is unusual. And it was kind of hard at first to digest everything. And seeing Alden Ehrenreich as Han, I said, okay, I have to let this in because I didn't have a problem with Chris Pine playing Kirk. You know, I didn't even question it, for example. You know, that whole crew played these iconic characters. But I've come to the realization since I've seen the trailer that he's not playing Harrison Ford. He's playing Han Solo.
Yeah.
And he's going to do a great job.
Yeah.
And he's already, you know, the more I watch the trailer, the more I see that essence, that swagger, you know, the whole thing that Han Solo is. I think he's going to do a really great job. And Han Solo, this ain't his first rodeo, or Han Solo, or Ron Howard, sorry, not his first rodeo. He's proven that he's been on in terms of casting and directing. And so, again, you know, like I always say, you just have to trust the powers that be. But I do have to say one thing as far as the villain goes. I've been thinking and thinking and thinking. Could that be Paul Bettany's character, possibly?
Oh.
I think there's a chance. I think that's a chance. I think it's also possible that Bettany's, you know, he was added. Who did he replace in the movie? I can't remember which actor he replaced because of the scheduling conflict with the reshoots.
It was the guy from The Wire.
Exactly. But but I'm also wondering if one of the reasons we didn't see Bettany is because his scenes were filmed so much later that maybe they just aren't ready with the special effects shots. But I like that thought. And I just want to touch on something that both of you have said, you know, with Alden Ehrenreich playing Han Solo. I loved his reaction to that line that Emilia Clarke delivers in the second trailer, you know, when she says, I might be the only person who knows what you really are. And then he gets that smirk and he goes, what's that? And just and then later in the trailer, when he's flying the Falcon and you know, that line that I quoted in the rundown, as they're flying away from the fighters and he flips the Falcon over outside, knocks one of them an asteroid. He goes, I thought we were in trouble there for a second, but it's fine. We're fine. I
mean, the first thing I thought of was we're fine. We're all fine here now.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Wow. Yeah.
Exactly. And you know, one of the other things is that I haven't had a chance to read the story, and we're not going to be able to get into all the Entertainment Weekly stuff that came out. But apparently, Harrison Ford gave Ehrenreich some sort of a blessing about this whole thing. And
now look, kid, has him father, son, and or Force Ghost.
Indeed. So you know, make sure you check that out over at Entertainment Weekly.
So,
but also they said that he had consulted with him. That he had had lunch with him and that he kind of stayed on almost as Kathleen Kennedy even had verified that, I guess, that Harrison Ford was kind of behind the scenes sort of consulting with Alden. But look, I don't know. Kid,
when you're trying, don't look like you're trying. The girls
exactly.
let me ask you this real quick. Okay, so, in a past Scoundrels Halloween episode, we initiated the joke that Han Solo was secretly a trust fund baby. Do you think that might be who, you know, and okay, so here's the thing. Do you think maybe, and I know we don't want to get into speculation, but Emilia Clarke looks dressed to the nines, so to speak. And obviously they're getting their hands on this really nice ship. Do you think she's kind of maybe rich herself? And that's why she knows who Solo really is. I don't know. I'm just saying.
No, hanging
I don't
out with think the bad so. Boy.
The, you know, the what does he say at the beginning of the trailer? It's like, he says something to the effect that I've been pulling scams on these streets since I was 10.
Right.
And that, you know, he's out to try, you know, he wants to join the academy and become the best star, the best pilot in the galaxy, but he gets kicked out of the flight academy for having a mind of his own. Mm-hmm. I suppose it's possible, that but if he really me. Was a trust fund baby, you know, why is he getting into so much trouble with his debts to Jabba later in you know, A New Hope? So I don't know. It's the I don't know what her story is.
Because the rich are crazy. I'm just saying. They're weird. Okay.
Well, let's get a bit further into the character discussion. Jay, you know, why don't you tell us a bit about the teaser posters we saw?
Oh, yeah. Are you talking about the ones that are kind of the Western ones?
Exactly.
With the yes. So we did get those trailer posters with that. And there are four posters for the movie, including a poster for Solo, Lando, Kira, which is Emilia Clarke's character, and Chewie. Each has a Western theme and uses a different primary color. So red for Solo, purple for Kira, blue for Lando, and yellow for Chewie. So an updated image of the Falcon with the TIE fighters in pursuit is at the bottom of each poster with the Solo, a Star Wars Story logo on the top.
Huh. Okay.
So, yeah. So those are pretty cool. So, they're very, yeah, very Western themed.
So there's the official announcement of Emilia Clarke's character name, Kira.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Which also was the placeholder name in The Force Awakens, remember? For Rey.
Yeah, it was.
But it was spelled differently.
Yeah, and a lot of people really ran with it that that's exactly what her name was going to be before they all insisted that it was Jaina Solo. So, good times. What did you all think of the posters and which one was your favorite?
Honestly, I don't know how I feel about them. They're cool. They're different. They're not something that we've seen from Star Wars promos before. In some ways, I feel it's almost a contradiction to the overall feel of the trailers that we got. They were so gritty and dark. And then we get these really, really colorful character posters. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of a contradiction in that way, but I can understand why they did it. And I guess that there was some connection also to some of the locations as far as the colors that they picked. So I guess time will tell. And yeah.
Hey, so which one was your favorite?
I liked the Kira one because I love purple. So
this is a good one. Huh?
So let me ask you this real quick. Are these the same colors, you know, the shirt that Andy Gutierrez was wearing on the Star Wars show? Are these the same colors that we see on those shirts too?
No, that's a Force for Change shirt. The shirt that she had on had some red and orange in it, and it was like a baseball ringer shirt with a black collar and hemmed sleeves.
Okay.
But I don't think it had anything to do with the posters. I could be wrong.
Okay.
But I don't think it did.
Well, let me ask you this. So do you believe that maybe... I believe, let me say this, that color denotes tone and intent, right? Not so sure about the red, blue, and yellow per se, but purple. Purple is
you the really color. Are on that theme.
Well, I'm just saying purple is the color of royalty, you know.
I understand what you're saying, and I don't know how much of that they're trying to signal with the posters.
Well, they said location.
Yeah,
that's what I saw.
I was interested in the way you viewed this as a contradiction, Jay, the posters compared to the trailers.
Yeah.
I thought they were a really great compliment because I really got that Western vibe from the, from that train and the, you know, the heist angle they were going and getting tongue tied here, but the standoff that Solo had with, you know, what the apparent villain is, and Woody Harrelson's character was, you know, recruiting a team for some sort of a heist. I kind of felt this Western theme really blended in. I think maybe you're referring more to the brightness of the colors with the press there. But
the design itself was definitely Western feeling for sure.
Yeah. But I love these posters. I rearranged my office and let me tell you, I've got most of my wall space full But if I can find, you know, 8x11 versions of those things, I'm going to be hanging them up on my walls.
Yeah, you still have a ceiling.
But it's angled. Things don't hang from it so well there. And there's also a ceiling fan that would knock stuff down. But these were fantastic, and it was nice to get that official announcement or the official confirmation of Kira as the character name for Amelia Clark's character.
Yeah, those are awesome posters, and you're right. I mean, it does feel like good, the bad, the ugly to a certain extent. Or Starship Sabers and Scoundrels are there little image. That's right. So, well, Lucasfilm wasn't done with the Solo revelations with the posters either, guys. They also released a set of high-resolution press images. The images were scenes from the trailers, but they included the information that Woody Harrelson is playing Beckett, and not the TV series that had Sam Malone, or whatever his name is. Phoebe Waller-Bridge is L337, and Thandie Newton is playing Val. So, I really don't know what to make with these names.
Well, a couple things. First off, L337 is kind of a takeoff on that leet language that you saw in a lot of forums for video gamers and gamers, and in fact where the numbers look like letters. In this case, the threes look like E's and that seven looks kind of like a T. So I'm wondering if that's a direct reference, which I found that they're going with that much of a real world late 90s early 2000s cultural reference that for the droid's name.
Inside baseball. Wow.
Yeah, and then I was a little surprised that Thandie's Newton character is Val. A lot of people had been theorizing or speculating that maybe she was Sana Staros, which was the character that alleged that she was Han Solo's wife
in
the comics after they staged some sort of a heist and he cut her out of her share of the loot from the thing. And so given the feel of the trailers were, I think that was kind of actually a natural assumption to make if they were keeping, but hey, you know, maybe Val is another pseudonym because she, you know, she was going around calling herself Sana Solo for a while before her real last name was revealed. So who knows?
That's true.
But I, you know, I don't have enough information. Okay. But I really like L337. We have not heard her talk, but that synchronized thing she did with Solo when they were getting ready to go out of hyperspace in the trailer with the hand movements, that just, she looks like the perfect companion for Lando other than Lobot.
Right.
Well, and you know what I thought too, I have to bring this up with the whole salute thing, that, you know, Lando gives that same salute in Empire Strikes Back to Han, and they both did it. L337 and Lando both did it in the trailer. And so it got me thinking, you know, when Beckett, Woody Harrelson says, you know, I'm putting together a team, could that be some sort of like a team symbol, you know, like the Gloomwalkers did in Darth Bane, where they had the close fist over the heart type thing. So you know
do
what
you
I mean?
Do you mean Empire or like do you mean like Return of the Jedi?
It was Return of the Jedi.
Okay, yep. Okay. So I know what you're talking about. Yeah,
he goes, I'm mixing my metaphors here.
Yeah, so. I know it is. I know it's right after Han tells him. Yeah,
pickup, Jay.
Yeah, that's a really good pickup.
I hadn't even thought about that, but that's a good catch. I like that. You know, maybe it is, or you know, maybe it's just something that means something to them. You know, as after, you know, it was just Lando's thing and they all picked it up.
Joke, it's like the finger on the side of the nose with the sting, you know, that showed who was kind of in on it. You know what I mean?
Right,
it's like
their
little symbol they do to each other. Yeah.
So I'd be interested. But that whole, that image of Lando and the EU and image with him with the Sabacc cards. I can't wait to see them play Sabacc.
Yep.
Oh my goodness.
Yep.
Well, I can't even spit it out. I'm getting tongue-tied too.
We could talk about
there's
Solo.
There's just so much.
Yeah. We could talk about the Solo news all evening if we wanted to. I just want to point out a few other things that we just simply don't have time to get into. But Entertainment Weekly has got even more images that just came out today. And this is the 7th of February when recording this. They've got that story about Harrison Ford coaching Alden Ehrenreich. And then the Star Wars show focus on all the Solo news, and they had a close-up of the Falcon, the exterior performance, and it turns out that was inspired very much by Ralph McQuarrie's painting of the Falcon with a single cannon on the top, the dish that's sitting on the top of the ship pointing upward, and just that overall appearance. So definitely check out Entertainment Weekly and the Star Wars Show for a bit more information. We've got one last news story left. And if all the Solo news wasn't enough, Lucasfilm made another completely unexpected set of announcements. More Star Wars is coming. And that's a deliberate pun. Game of Thrones creators David, how do you pronounce this name? Benioff and D.B. Weiss are to write and produce a new series of Star Wars films. These films will be separate from the episodic Skywalker saga movies and the recently announced trilogy being developed by The Last Jedi's Rian Johnson.
So cool. Yeah.
And if that wasn't enough, on a quarterly call with investors, Bob Iger announced that they are developing multiple properties for Star Wars properties for the streaming service that's set to debut at the end of next year.
Wow. Just wow. Wow. So we could get all of our little wish lists about, oh, what would they make for a TV show? You know what I mean? Wow. Yeah. Oh my gosh. I mean, this is great. They're going Marvel. They're making this marvelous, you know? I mean, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm excited, man.
Yeah.
I have not been a regular Game of Thrones viewer. I've read the first two books in the series. I've watched the first three or four episodes of the first season, and I've seen an episode here and there. I just don't have HBO. I enjoy what I see. It's just not something that I'm making time for right now. I've actually purchased the first season of Game of Thrones for streaming, and I just never got around to watching it. But you know, more Star Wars. Still don't have an announcement about the Kenobi movie that everyone insists is coming. And here we have a trilogy being developed by Rian Johnson and a series of films. Now, that, you know, notice they didn't say trilogy, but a series of films by these Game of Thrones writers. So, anyway.
Hey Siri, search for more Star Wars.
You'll probably find a lot, and that's a good problem to have.
So anyway, but so that's going to do it for our look at the news. There's plenty that we haven't even touched on. And so I would recommend to our listeners that you go to retrozap.com and check out Courtney Martin's column. She's keeping up with everything.
Yeah.
Go to FanTheTrax, check out Jedi News, TheForce.net, Coffee with Kenobi. There's plenty of great sites that are keeping track of all these things for you. At least StarWars.com. Yeah. dropping something every day.
This is so wizard.
You feeling me, Hunter's wizard? I was just stepping through you, girl, with my intellectual wizard politics.
I'm an enchanter.
Wizards only, fools.
Wizards rule.
There are some who call me Tim.
Greetings, Tim the Enchanter.
Nope, wizards only. Wizards only, fools.
Welcome back to That's So Wizard, a monthly rundown of Star Wars fashion and lifestyle product news from all corners of the galaxy. With tomorrow being Valentine's Day, I thought I would bring you some ideas for spreading a bit of Star Wars love.
Oh, I love to spread Star Wars love.
And I've scoured the hyperspace lanes to find something for all walks of life. So sit back, grab your wallets, and get your add to cart fingers ready to go. And this time is a very special Han Solo Valentine's love focus as well.
Yeah.
So I kind of mixed a few things together there because it's a lot of I love you, I know products.
All right.
So if you head on over to ThinkGeek, they actually have a ton of these. So there's a faux leather strap, not fox leather strap, wrap bracelet with Han and Leia silhouettes in surgical stainless steel for both guys and gals, and it's on sale right now for $19.99. Sure. So it's kind of a stacked leather bracelet, sort of in straps, and it says, you know, I love you, and then it has Han and Leia, and then I know, and so both guys and girls can wear that, which is pretty cool.
So is it dividable? I mean, it kind of looks like it's
It's all one. It's just sectioned.
Okay.
It's actually all one bracelet, but it's just sectioned, so you can't break it up.
Okay.
But yeah, Yeah. And then there's a coffee mug. And it, of course, it says, I love you, I know. And it's got that wonderful scene in The Falcon when Han and Leia share their first kiss. Oh. With little hearts abound all over. And that's only $5.99, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, it's a good price. Yeah.
It is. And then there's some men's cufflinks on sale for $19.99. And so you can have Leia on one wrist saying, I love you. And Han on the other wrist saying, of course, I know.
Well, of course.
And then there are his and hers matching band rings.
Okay,
so there's
like these.
One for men. Yeah, isn't that really cool?
Yeah.
One for men, one for women. And those are on sale for $16.99. And my understanding is that you get both for the $16.99. So I'm not sure, you know, how great quality those are. But it does advertise that for people that have nickel allergies, that they do use the surgical stainless steel. So hopefully they would hold up. But on the inside is the Rebel Alliance logo. So you've got both a little bit of the wording, and then you also have that little Star Wars symbolization too. So you can share that.
So would you wear that? I mean, okay, you're married, you know, you've got the mark of eternal, you know, servitude on your left hand. Where would you wear this if you were married and you know what I mean?
I mean, basically anywhere you want to, I guess. I mean, you could wear it on a pinky, you could wear it on a middle finger, you could wear it on your thumb, you know, wherever you'd want to. But I you know, I kind of think it's cute for something like a promise ring even.
Yeah. Okay. That's, you know, more what I mean? I'm thinking. Yeah. Like engagement stuff. Right.
Or you could even thread a necklace through it and wear it as a necklace.
I think I think the Lady Taxus would prefer to wear this on her middle finger, to be honest.
Oh, I'm so glad you said that because I was thinking it.
Oh, goodness. I love you. I know.
Yeah. I get that a lot.
That's just her way of reminding you.
Oh, she does every day.
That would be perfect. Well, and if that weren't enough, there's also a reversible beanie, which is unisex, so either male or female can wear this. And so it says, I love you, in kind of a script. It's black with white lettering, and it has a cuff, so you can reverse it, and then you could wear it. I know.
Oh.
So I guess depending on what you're feeling like that day.
And it doesn't need other beanies to have more beanies because it's unisex, right?
Exactly.
Oh, okay.
So right. It does its own thing.
Oh, okay.
And then lastly on ThinkGeek, there are some stemless flute glasses on sale for $9.99 for the pair. And these are, they're kind of like those champagne glasses, but of course, that's why they're called stemless flute. And they are clear glass with a silver application on them. So there is the Leia, I love you, and then the Han, I know. So they have a bunch of really fun stuff that's Han and Leia themed. And not to be outdone, Fox Lunch also has matching his and hers t-shirts for $28.90 each. So there's an I love you, I know. And these are more cartoonish style, almost comic book style in their coloring, but they're black, and they're both the boxy type cut. And so there's one for a guy and one for a girl.
Yeah, there's sort of that.
However your significant other might be.
There's sort of that 80s style, like kind of, I can't remember the term, but, you know, there's a specific term for that art. I'm not an artist.
Well, it reminds me of the Aha Take On Me.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? When I look at it. Yeah. So it's a couple's t-shirt, and that's a Box Lunch exclusive.
Yeah, we actually, the Lady Taxus and I actually have a variant of these. Her t-shirt says, I'm with stupid, and mine says, I know.
Oh, yeah, we sell those at our county fair. Yeah, people buy those up all the time.
Yeah.
And I actually have, and I have to throw this in here as an extra, I have a necklace that my husband had got me for Sweetest Day, and I believe he got it on HSC or HSN, Home Shopping Network, or QVC, one of those. And it's kind of like a ring in a way. It's more of an Alex and Annie style, and it's a twisted ring, and it says I love you, and then I know inside the ring.
Aww.
So that's actually one of my favorite necklaces because it's very very dainty and it goes with just about everything, but it's silver. And but yeah, that's a great one too. So if you're in need of an idea, there's that. And then again, undergarments. I don't know what it is, but I guess I like to talk about underwear. So here we go.
Why not?
They're always a popular gift at Valentine's Day. And Box Lunch actually has some boxer briefs for $25.90 each. And there are a few different styles available. There's a Death Star, there's a TIE Fighter approaching a Death Star with an X-Wing on it as well, and that one's got a black background. And then there's an Endor scene that has Han on it at the bunker with an Ewok and then Leia on a speeder. And then there is a Hoth scene. Mm-hmm. So on the front, there's Luke with the Tauntaun, and then on the back is Han Solo. Hmm. Okay. So you can say it with me. I thought those boxer briefs smelled bad.
Oh, gosh. That's wonderful.
Terrible joke.
So, okay. So the Death Star is on the backside of those, that yes. one. Yeah. So that's no moon.
It's actually more up on the hip.
Oh, okay. Okay. And these are edible, right? Because they're box lunch?
No. Oh. But do you know how box lunch actually operates? Do you want to know?
Packing underwear.
They donate part of what you buy to helping to provide meals, box lunches.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So okay. and then you get lunchbox money back. So you get a little coupon with for every however many dollars you spend, you also get a coupon back in your shipment that you can spend on something else. So it's a kind of a win-win situation there. But yeah, so that's kind of cool. And Spencer's Online also has some men's boxer shorts as well for $15.99.
Oh, okay. So, I was kind of hoping the Hoth ones would taste like cherry, but
the snozzberries taste like snozzberries though.
Why not?
Okay. So a quick search of Etsy. If you want some more undergarments. They had 314 items with the tag Star Wars lingerie. 314.
Wow.
For both men and women, ranging in prices and fabric from very little all the way up to over $150. And I will say viewer discretion is advised.
So you mean very little price and fabric?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. Just be aware when you go there that you don't want any kids in the room. All right. So this brings me to the final bit of sharing the love. This month's Wizard Award. Yay! Yay! And the award is simply an honorific title that I choose to give to a shop, product, or person whom I feel deserves some extra attention. So this time I felt, you know, candles, they definitely add a great romantic ambiance to any dinner or cozy evening at home.
Hey now.
And I found an independent little candle company that caters to the fan in all of us. So Big Whiff Candles. This is a company started by a husband and wife team from Pennsylvania who needed to find a way to supplement their income after deciding to start a family and coming to the realization that being in the welding field was not an optimal choice for mom. So she decided to stay home, raise their kids, but they needed some kind of a supplemental, you know, income. So they brainstormed, they came up with the candle idea. And since 2015, they've expanded from glass containers to cans, melts, and a wide variety of scents. So I actually just kind of randomly found this company on Amazon.com and I ended up getting a couple of candles. Lindsay was kind enough to send me two of their Star Wars inspired scents, Mandalorian Mist, which the scent is listed as Mandalorian Iron.
Yeah.
Which I'm not sure how that actually smells. Beskar Gam, Sandalwood, Musk, and Citrus, but it does smell really good. We were actually burning that one last weekend during our family game night when we play cards together as a fam.
Awesome.
And yeah, an Ewok Village, which is redwood, balsam, pine, myrrh, and tea tree. And that one smells really good too. And my whole decor in my house is, I would call it like modern rustic. It's like modern log cabin-ish.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
it actually smells really, really good. And they're soy wax with a lead-free cotton wick. And I'm very pleased with the scents and the longevity of the candles themselves. The scents are not overpowering, but you definitely get that whole room full of the fragrance kind of thing. And the wick kind of sizzles and cracks as it burns. And I think that's a neat addition to the overall ambiance because they're cotton. And they are advertised at a 40-hour burn time. And the can itself is adorned in a Star Wars scene and it has a little wit lid with it as well. So it's really cool. And if you follow me on Twitter and Instagram, I've posted some pictures of the ones that I have. And I'm excited to try the Shores of Scarif next. Mm-hmm. So they have the wax melts. I actually ordered it today. I had a snow day today and that's not really good for my wallet, but it was all Star Wars stuff, so it's good. But Shores of Scarif has ocean breeze, sea moss, sea salt, citrus, white musk, and driftwood.
And the smells of freshly made glass.
Yeah, there you go.
Yes.
And all kinds of fun stuff. So they're $10 each, the candles do. They measure about 2 inches high, 3 inches in diameter. You get 6 ounces of wax. Some of the other fun scents, I have to tell you, Vader's breath.
Oh.
Yeah, which might not be what you think. It's smoke, fire, cedar, and musk. Which
definitely not what I thought.
Yeah.
Well, the last time I ate cedar that was on fire and smoky, I kind of have that breath too.
Yeah, I don't know if I want to really smell Vader's breath, but Jabba's Palace, golden sand, musk, cedar, eucalyptus, and amber.
Pretty cool. Rancor poop.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Icy Winds of Hoth, which is mint, sparkling snow, licorice, tonka bean, which kind of smells, if you've never smelled that scent before, it's kind of like a mix of vanilla, cherry, and almost cinnamon.
And a child's toy.
Kind of an interesting. Yeah, and a toy. Yeah. Musk moss and woods. And then Sands of Tatooine, which is sand, spicy ginger, and Jaipur ivory wood. So they have tons of them. They even have now they even started doing Marvel scents as well. So
like Iron Man.
Like Marvel. Yeah, exactly.
Inside. And Hulk shorts. Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So they're all but the wax melts are $5 each and you get 6 melts totaling 3 ounces. So I'm really excited to try Shores of Scarif coming to my home soon. And I received a message that they actually already tagged it to be shipped. So I just ordered it today. Cool. So the shipping is really, really, really quick. Yeah. So you can find them on Etsy, Amazon, or you can order direct from bigwhiffcandle.com. And they are on Instagram at Big Whiff Candle, and they are also on Facebook. So congratulations, Big Whiff Candles.
Well, I love the canned candle. I think that's cool.
Yes.
Yeah.
And they actually called them man candles for a while.
Mandals.
Because some of the scents were mostly catered towards the fine aficionado nasals of the man, but they've expanded.
Well, you know.
So it's kind of a family business, and that's really cool. So congratulations, Big Whiff Candle. And that's So Wizard.
No. I shouldn't have done that.
I'm sorry.
Hey, so it's Valentine's Day soon, right?
Tomorrow.
Yeah. And if the Scoundrels, and Dennis, remember, last year we had a little fun with some special messages for the Scoundrels.
I remember because I recorded one of them for you guys before I was an official.
That's right.
Team. Yes.
And I feel like it was episode 23 or something like that. I don't know. Just off the top of my head. Not sure. But if anybody wants to go back and listen to that, they're more than welcome to. So how do you guys feel about hearing some new Valentine's messages to the Scoundrels?
I'm mildly afraid, but I'll do it for the Scoundrels.
As well you should be, Dennis. So what I have, if everybody remembers, this is kind of a little bit of a game too. So these messages are from a Star Wars character to another Star Wars character. And after you listen to them, you get to guess who they are from and to whom they are written to. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so, since, you know, ladies honors, then this first one, Jay, you can take a crack at. And if it's not quite right, Dennis, throw in your 2 cents and then vice versa. Okay.
Sounds good.
All right. Well, let's listen to the first one. Let me get the music all queued up and here we go.
Hey everybody, this is Tim McMahon from Less Than 12 Parsecs, the fastest Star Wars podcast in the galaxy, and I'm here today with a very special Scoundrels Valentine to my newfound special friend. When we first met, I could tell by the way you looked at me that you had carnal intentions. But the moment you gazed into my eyes, I became more to you than the others you've burnt before. And when you happily sling me around, it makes me cry out in excitement. I'm happy we were able to get past a hairy situation. Our love flies on high. Your only chick.
Okay. So, Jay, who do you think that was written from and to whom was it intended?
Okay. It hit me at the very, very end. It's Chewbacca and a porg.
Okay. Let's go ahead. And Dennis, do you have an idea?
Not anything different than what Jay just said.
All right. Well,
it's the porg to Chewbacca.
Okay. Let's see if you're right.
The porg to Chewbacca. Happy Valentine's Day, Scoundrels. I hope you find love in your corner of the galaxy.
Yes! Wonderful. Wonderful. Woo-hoo! Good job. Good job, guys. Yeah, it's wonderful,
Jay. It was the chick. It was the chick thing that fly on high.
Yep, thanks. Yep. It's a chick flick, of course. But
Of course.
That's okay. So Jay's got one. All right. Let's listen to the next one. And Dennis, you're up on deck.
Alrighty.
All right. Okay. Just let me cue up the music here to get the romantic feeling. And here we go.
Hey there. This is Jovial Jay, host of Green Justice and Arrow podcast, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Case Files, and Scarlet Velocity, a Flash podcast here on RetroZap.com, as well as Jedi Journals over on ForceCast.net. And I have a special Scoundrels Valentine. To the one who took me in, I admit it. I was scared and surprised, but once you let me in, I discovered that you have a heart bigger than your mouth. And I know I offer a lot to digest because it was hard to break through my shell, but you have me trapped inside. You alone make me break down. And now I know I should stop struggling so that we can become one, your delight for eternity.
Well, I am disturbed to think that I might be on the same wavelength here as this Valentine. I'm not positive about this, but I am going to go with the Sarlacc and Boba Fett.
Okay. So who is it from and to whom is it written?
I think it was from the Sarlacc to... No, I think it was Boba Fett to the Sarlacc.
Well, let's see.
That was Boba Fett to the Sarlacc.
Nice.
Congratulations.
It's like he was almost there.
Wonderful. Wonderful. Dennis, nice. Man, you got the hang of it from last year.
Yeah, I had nowhere to go but up after last year.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, that is wonderful. Now, let's see. All right, this next message. Well, you know, 50 Shades of Grey is a interesting movie and series out. So, in that spirit, Jay, are you ready?
I am ready.
Greetings. This is Bill from the Dork Lair Collecting Podcast, and I have a special Scoundrels Valentine. To my great big hunk of a male, I resisted your clutches. I tried to hide behind my friends. You wanted to do things that made me feel strange and wear clothes that I would normally never put on. And now, I'm really into it. I hope you enjoy my new ideas. and that the chains don't freak you out so that you joke when we're together. I know I'm fine with the results. Your daring mistress.
Okay. Whoa, that was a little crazy.
Wow.
I'm a little scared. I don't know. But who was that? Or who was that from, and to whom do you think it was written?
Okay. Not that I ever think that she would actually say this to this person, but I think maybe it was Leia to Jabba.
Well, Dennis, do you have an idea?
I'm with Jay on this one. The hunk of a male is really a disturbing thought, but go ahead.
Right. Here we go.
Leia to Jabba.
Oh, hey! Awesome. Wow. Man, you guys are like 3 for 3. That's amazing. That's great. Which means next year I'm really going to have to up my game. So now we come upon the last special message for you, Dennis.
Hello.
Hi.
I'm Sophie.
And I'm Phil.
And we host the Star Wars podcast Bright Tree Radio. You can find us on Twitter at Bright Tree Radio, and you can hang out with the pod on iTunes and Podbean and Spreaker.
And we have a special Scoundrels Valentine.
To the soulmate I finally found. I never expected to meet someone like you, and I'm sorry that I seem so distant, but you had your secrets too, and you weren't sure if my father would approve of you. But I'm glad you let him live, even with my daddy issues. Through it all, I've learned we weren't that different, but our plans changed, and when I think of all the minutes we lost, it makes my passion explode in a flaming fury even more. I'm glad I can finally hold you in my arms. All my love, your little spy of love.
Okay. I'm pondering this one here. Spy, distance, explode. Soulmate, huh? Well, the exploding and spy portion of it is suggesting Jen Erso to me. Mm. However, I am not certain who she's talking to. So I'm gonna go out on a limb and say maybe Cassian Andor, simply because of the letting him live line in there.
Okay.
But, you know, it's hard being on the spot on these. So, Jay, what do you think?
Yeah, that was a tough one. I'm kind of thinking Jen Erso also, but I'm almost wondering if maybe she's talking to Krennic.
Oh, wow.
I don't know.
Okay, let's see what's
that. That would be a weird thing, but
yeah,
or even Saw.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know what you've been reading lately, but let's listen to the results. Here we go.
Jyn Erso to Cassian Andor.
Okay. Congratulations. Yay, all right, Dennis. Good job. All right. Oh.
Well, for the record, though, I don't think Leia would actually ever send a Valentine's to Jabba. So Jyn sending one to Krennic isn't out of the ballpark.
No. Yeah, well, we all sent one last year, so hey.
Yeah.
It's possible in Taxus' world. True.
But there might be a little bit more to this story, so why don't we give it a listen?
That was really beautiful.
Yes, I could feel the heat of their love. Oh, it looks like there's a PS.
Well, let's hear it.
P.S. I just feel I have so much more to write to you. But it's difficult with you watching me right now, as well as the fact there is a giant wall of fire from a super laser weapon blast heading towards us. It's interesting what questions go through your mind when you only have a few seconds to live. For example, do you think all the sand will turn to glass when the blast hits, or do you? Oh, it stops there. That's unfortunate.
What do you think he was going to go on to talk about?
What happened in the lift?
Da da da.
Well, yeah. Wow. Man. She's really okay. A fast writer, I guess. You know? Yeah.
She sure is.
Yeah, because I didn't remember seeing all that, but I don't know. She must have had a pen and paper with her. But
Well, Saw must have taught her shorthand or something.
Yeah, yeah. And thankfully, that's all he taught her after your weird scenario, Jay. Yeah, so happy Valentine's Day, scoundrels. And we hope that your love doesn't die in some fiery blast from a space laser super cannon.
It's a good thing you don't write for Hallmark. Good God.
Indeed.
As I mentioned earlier, the road to Solo has begun. As we count down the months, weeks, days, and hours to Solo a Star Wars story, we'll be focusing on things related to the best smuggler in the galaxy. And this week, we started all off with a discussion about bounty hunters. Most Star Wars fans got their first look at the independent intergalactic mercenaries in Empire Strikes Back when Darth Vader put a contract out on the Millennium Falcon. Since then, they have captured the imagination of fans everywhere. So let's start there, gang. What is the appeal of bounty hunters? Why is it that everyone is so fascinated with them? What do you think, Jay?
Well, I think part of that is just the idea of a human hunting another human. And it's that thrill of the hunt, you know? And I just think that it's a really interesting aspect of the whole Star Wars universe, because you've got these very clear good guys and very clear bad guys. And then you've got bounty hunters that are in the middle, and they don't really choose sides. They just go with whoever pays them the most money. And it's fascinating to me that the Empire would hire bounty hunters. It's almost like, wow, they've got all these resources and they're so far reaching in the galaxy. And, you know, when he said, we don't need their scum here, or whatever he said, it's the lore, and you want to know more, and you want to know where they came from and how they came to be. So I just think it's you know, there's a lot of aspects to why they're appealing.
Yeah, so I think part of the appeal to me is their independence and their resourcefulness. You know, the thing about it is, the Empire, that's very law and order, right? And I don't mean, you know, I mean, it's just like the established order of the galaxy. And so Imperial spies, Imperial officers, Imperial law enforcement's not necessarily going to be able to get information they need or to the places they need to, but bounty hunters can. Because they're not cops, you know. They have contacts. They've got different things that they've gone through, different connections, and so it's not surprising to me that the Empire would use them. And I have to say, from a personal aspect, in my multifaceted past, very spotty employment history, I actually had run-ins with bounty hunters in real life. And the first thing that went through my head when they identified themselves as bounty hunters was...
A blaster bolt?
No, but I thought, I don't need your scum.
Yeah.
I have to say. So, yeah, it is. But it's. I think that's the appeal to me, is that they're just kind of independence. You know, they're sort of like... It's like the Mike Hammer kind of private investigator feeling, you know?
Sure.
Yeah.
They're a bit of a contradiction for the Empire, because as you mentioned, the Empire is all this law and order. And what sense does it make to have independent, heavily armed citizens in vehicles that are armed with concussion missiles and various blasters roaming your galaxy, and you tolerate this? It's that Imperial officer aboard the Star Destroyer when Vader summoned them and said, bounty hunters, we don't need their scum. And Bossk is sitting there to, snarl at him. And, so I don't think there's a uniform view about this subject. Vader employed them as a means to an end. And then, in the comics, we've seen that Palpatine had a couple of bounty hunters on his speed dial as well. Mm-hmm. But, I don't know. It's just one of those things that's always been interesting for a lot of reasons, because they are elite soldiers. If they weren't better than the common soldier, you wouldn't need them. You could just send a squad of stormtroopers out there to get the job done. What would one guy do that doesn't have any special training or special skills that a squad of stormtroopers couldn't do? I guess maybe hit the target. I don't know. But with that being said, Boba Fett was the face of bounty hunters for decades. Even though, you know, the Empire Strikes Back introduced us to a whole bunch of them, you know, Boba Fett, Bosk, Dengar, Forlom, Zuskus, and Zuckus, all the same. And same time, it was still Boba Fett that got featured because he's the one that tracked down Han Solo and showed up in Return of the Jedi. But, you know, there's been, I don't want to turn into a Boba Fett discussion because there's been plenty of those. And, you know, he largely got by on his mysteriousness and mystique. But, you know, over the years, what have been some of your all's favorite bounty hunters and why?
Well, for me, I mean, there's a whole list of them. Of course, you know, like you said, on the Falcon, just that first array that we saw. But real quick, getting back to what you said, too, with Palpatine and the appeal of the bounty hunters, they were expendable for him. And they also drew the focus away from what he was doing. So, oh, here, look at this bounty hunter, as opposed to focusing on, oh, could this have been a Sith that did this? So there's that too. But of course, Boba Fett has always had my heart in a lot of ways, but there's been so many of them over the years. It's so hard, but Zam Weasel definitely comes to mind. She was hired by Jango. I mean, so that's saying something, a bounty hunter that hires another bounty hunter.
Subcontracting, you know, kind
of. Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, of course, there's Embo and Ketsu Anyo and Asajj Ventress, who had a little stint as a bounty hunter for a little while.
Yeah.
Bazine Natal, whose backstory is explored, of course, in The Perfect Weapon, which is a really cool book.
And Jay keeps stealing all my favorite bounty hunters. Go ahead, Jay. No. Keep going.
So I'll only say one more then, because I bet you don't have this one on your list, because this is a legend. This isn't canon.
Okay.
Tahiri Vela. Yeah. I love Tahiri Vela. Where you? No, you weren't.
I just did. You at silly same time goose. With you.
But I love Tahiri in all aspects, and just the fact that she was a bounty hunter for a while just makes her even more of a cool chick in my book. So.
Yeah, sure. All right. Yeah, you know, okay, so that's interesting. This might seem like a rote response, but I'm just going to say my favorite bounty hunter is Boba Fett. And I have a reason why. Dennis, you kind of touched on it. It's more the mystique than the action, right? Mm-hmm. You said, like, they're better than, you know, super soldiers or something to that effect. But I might argue maybe they're not. You know, the best way to capture somebody is by not getting into a fight with them. You know, figuring out the best way to remove their ability to escape. And that involves outwitting them. And so, you know, you think about what Boba Fett did in Empire Strikes Back. He kind of put two and two together and said, hey, the Empire's been chasing these people around here, and for some reason they can't escape. I'm just going to chill out with the Empire and, you know, see what I find. And that's what he did. He just kind of outthought, you know, the rebels. And even on Bespin, you know, he didn't go toe-to-toe with Luke Skywalker. He fired a couple of shots at him, you know. So he's not necessarily, I mean, been proven as, just because he's been wearing the Mandalorian armor, that doesn't necessarily mean he's got, like, Super Mando skills or anything. Unless, you know, I mean, unless we still...
dad.
Well, yeah, I mean, we don't know yet, right? Exactly who the modern incarnation of Boba Fett is. But beyond that, I would say the one bounty hunter that I think of when you talk about martial arts would be Embo, because we saw him in the Clone Wars, and he was chasing down Anakin and Padme in the couple episodes I'm thinking of, and he was pretty tense, you know what I mean? He was pretty tough, and he had you know, the equivalent of a hound with him that was highly trained. So I would say Embo is probably like my other favorite, you know,
right.
And well, all the other ones Jay mentioned that I like too.
If you look at the generations of stars we have, you know, Boba Fett, you know, he really showed up in the, dare I mention it, Star Wars Holiday Special first.
Briefly
in that animated portion. And then of course he was in the Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi. So he was kind of the first face of the bounty hunters. Then we had Jango Fett, his father, when the prequels rolled around, and you know, that's where we showed off the super soldier skills. It was not so much the better than super soldiers. It was the additional skills I was referring to earlier.
Right.
But, you know, he went toe to toe to Obi-Wan before he lost to Mace Windu. Got his head taken off there. Mm-hmm. And
Mace Windu got ahead of him.
Yeah, exactly. Obi-Wan may have beat him then, but Obi-Wan needed him alive because he needed information. So he wasn't kind of free just to go all out on Jango. But then I kind of feel like the face of the bounty hunters in the past 10 years became Cad Bane. Then that, you know, the sequel trilogy hasn't given us a bounty hunter yet. The First Order hasn't employed any that we know of so far.
Well, Bazine.
Yeah, but not to the extent that we saw them when the prequel and the original trilogy movies, where they took real front and stage, you know, Bazine, got on the comm?
Yeah, for like 2 seconds.
Well, exactly.
Okay, would you consider from the comics Agent Terex to kind of be a bounty hunter?
No, he's an agent of the First Order before he becomes an automaton of the First Order. Okay. But my point being is that if you look at Cad Bane, he had a wide variety of skills. One, good with blaster. Mm-hmm. Two, he was really good at getting other bounty hunters and minions to do what it was he wanted, whether he was cajoling them, convincing them, just generally being, you know, that he had some sort of a charisma that these other bounty hunters flocked to. Mm-hmm. And then he had those infiltration skills when he broke into the Jedi temple to steal a holocron.
Yeah.
He was good at disguise. He had a lot of guile. You know, that was a guy who had a full array. That's kind of become one of my favorite bounty hunters simply because, well, his personality, you know, this old Western gunslinger thing that he had going on, which has kind of been a theme we've had with Solo.
Yeah.
That's been I've just been drawn to him because as cool as the mystique of Boba Fett and Jango was, once you got past that with Boba Fett, there wasn't much else there. Or, you know, they're kind of reinventing him now with the new comics. He hasn't really showed up in the books too much lately.
Well, he was very intelligent too, and I think that was his appeal. I mean, if you think about the Maul comic, you know, the crew that he ascended.
Referring to Cad Bane, right?
Yeah, Cad Bane, right. All the bounty hunters there kind of looked to him for leadership. And again, he kind of outthought what Maul was doing to a certain, you know what I mean? Was like, he was two steps ahead of Maul in the game, you know? And I think that's, you're right. Cad Bane is awesome. And in fact, wouldn't it be awesome if they've been hiding the fact that Cad Bane is going to be in the Solo movie? And maybe that's the mysterious character that, Paul Bettany had to come in to portray.
Yeah.
I mean, how awesome would that be?
Yeah, that would be awesome. I'm wondering the character that Paul Bettany was stepping into the roles for was supposed to be some sort of a humanoid furry looking thing, was my understanding.
Well, sorry.
And so, right. And then don't apologize. And then the shots we saw of Bettany from the set, he was just Paul Bettany in a Star Wars looking Scoundrels outfit.
But he's tall, like we would expect that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I like the thought. And you know, that would be an incredible reveal if that villain in the mask ended up being Cad Bane for some reason. But I guess one of the things that has kind of occurred to me over the course of this conversation is we have a lot of iconic character types in Star Wars. We, you know, Han Solo is the iconic smuggler. Mm. We have the Jedi, we have the troopers, and then we have the Sith. And to a degree, within their own fields, you know, you have different types of, most of the smugglers and scoundrels we've seen have been human. The Jedi are diverse, but at the end of the day, they're typically wearing robes and carrying a lightsaber.
Yeah.
The troopers are typically wearing armor and carrying blasters. The Sith have a bit more diversity in it, but again, some sort of monk type robes and sabers and lightning types.
But late for formal affairs, I might add.
Sure. Mm-hmm. But then the bounty hunters, they have their own kind of iconography there with, you know, they carry blasters, they use rockets, some of them are droids, some of them, they're various aliens. They kind of all do their own thing. Mm-hmm.
That's a good point, Dennis. Yeah.
All right. Did either of you read many of the Legends books that had to do with the bounty hunters and this whole guild system that they had established?
Give me some of the timeline or some of the names, because I remember reading Bloodlines, which was all about Boba Fett, but that was more of his It was a completely different thing. So
that was more Mandalorian days. But there was that Boba Fett trilogy where it was the Mandalorian armor. I think it was Paul Kemp maybe read that, wrote that. And then they, you know, had the, you know, there was a, but it was basically Boba Fett. It was a Boba Fett centric book, and he was tracking down a target. I can't get into all the details. It's been decades, but there was this, it kind of spilled over across several novels that they kind of had a guild system, which in my opinion kind of needlessly complicated the bounty hunters. You talked about it earlier. They have this independence about them, and you know, pick up contracts and they do the thing, and then suddenly I think the system, like the guild system that they put into the legends, took away from that. It kind of made them organized, and at that point, are they really all that different than a Jedi Order or a Sith Order?
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, because I always felt like Vader reached out independently to those who he knew he could trust, you know, to pull off a job. You know, that's why those bounty hunters were assembled on the Star Destroyer. You know, I do remember the guild kind of concept and stuff from the, you know, that series of books about, you know, the Jedi manual. It's not a manual, but you know what I mean. You know, the Sith manual. And sure, there was a bounty hunter one, too. And yeah, you're right.
Bounty hunter code.
Yeah. And it had this like real kind of like set up kind of rules and regulations, so to speak. And, you know, to a certain extent, any profession is going to have that, right? I mean, you're not going to want to do something that others that do your job would frown upon as being bad form. You know what I mean? And I think that's what the intention was for establishing that whole guild system kind of concept. But it also felt more like, you know, I can't remember what the anime is. A fairy tale. That's right. And in this anime, like, there's missions that come up, and the grandmaster of this house that these wizards belong to in fairy tale, the grandmaster says, okay, this mission needs to be handled by this level wizard, and this one is by this level, or something like that. You know, that's kind of what it felt like. It was like, you know, you must be this awesome to establish this or take on this bounty, you know? And I don't know. I guess that's kind of part and parcel to the whole EU thing, where it just kind of went a little too role-playing game feeling, you know?
Sure. Yeah. Well, you know, the other thing when you think about it is that, you know, Jay, you were talking earlier about Asajj Ventress. You know, she stepped into the role of a bounty hunter for a while. And you could do that with the bounty hunters. They all had their own motivations. Some of them had a sense of honor. I'm thinking of in the Clone Wars when Boba Fett was a kid and he kind of came under Ara Sing's big role for a while. And, you know, she was very driven to do some things that were morally questionable. And, you know, eventually Hondo kind of convinced Boba's like, yeah, your dad was an honorable guy and you don't need to do that. But the bounty hunters kind of had that range where the Jedi, if you fell afoul of their rules and the code, you were going to get expelled from the order. And the Siths, you know, the Sith code was more of a thing of legends, but still they still had their rule of two, and this whole gaining power and doing it under a code of secrecy, that there wasn't a lot of room for individualism in these other orders, where, you know, IG-88, you know, is wandering around this gigantic tall droid. It doesn't say much, but kind of
supposed to be illegal, by the way.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, he's essentially another
an assassin droid.
Battle droid.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Right. So, exactly. But the Empire is willingly using him. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Do you all have a favorite bounty hunter story from, you know, whether any one of the movies or Clone Wars or any of the other titles?
Ooh, that's a good question. I really do love Jass Amari's backstory, just being related to Sugi from the Clone Wars. That was her aunt. And just that whole idea of this generational type thing. But yeah, I would really have to think about that if I wanted to. Although, you know what? One that does come to mind, which the real Rako Hardeen wasn't actually part of this, but when Obi-Wan portrayed Rako Hardeen and they did that, the whole, the box Oh, yeah. Clone Wars, yeah. And they had to compete against each other. That's probably, as far as a storyline is concerned, that's probably my favorite one.
Yeah, that's cool. You know, I have one. It's legend now, but it involved Boba Fett, you know? And there was a space pirate. It kind of reminded me of a big whale for some reason. I don't remember exactly why, but one of the Hutts hired Boba Fett to, you know, take him out. And so the whole story was Boba Fett, you know, infiltrating this group and basically, you know, defeating everybody so he could take this, you know, space captain who was very piratey, yar, and all that stuff, back to the Hutt. And at the end, because he was the Hutt's enemy, the Hutt, of course, had him cooked and served for dinner.
Gee whiz, Jackson.
Yeah, well, I'm just saying, yeah, I mean, it wasn't me did the comic. I'm just saying it was kind of a cool story, you know, because Boba was like, yeah, I don't really care whatever you do. I'm just doing the job, you know? But of course, that would be something like a Hutt would do, right?
Right.
And it was just very, it was the first time I really saw Boba in action, you know, as being, like you said, like the awesome character that we all imagined him to be. So, yeah. And I can't remember that comic. Scoundrels, shout out to me, you know, and help me remember. So,
yeah, Boba Fett got a lot of treatment in the comics back in the Dark Horse days. Yeah. And it's a little unfortunate that we've kind of lost those from the current storyline. But
yeah,
those are definitely something to go back and look at. You know, the bounty hunters, I think there's a bit of fatigue in general for them, based off the sheer volume of attention they got during the Legends era of Star Wars. And so there just hasn't been as many stories about them in the past, you know, 4 or 5 years, I would say, outside of, you know, what Cad Bane and some of those bounty hunters are doing towards the end of Clone Wars. But as you mentioned, Taxus, Theo, Cad Bane and Ara Sing's appearance with a few other bounty hunters in the Darth Maul series was a good one. Recently, the Mace Windu comic, I'm not sure if he was really a bounty hunter or just a mercenary, but they had a droid there named ADW-4. A lot of people referring to him as WD-40, who was, you know, kind of a, you know, just, I don't care. I'm not exactly sure why he had to be a droid, but he definitely had that mercenary, I'm in it for the money type of a business going on. So that's right. Kind of the closest they've gotten to a bounty hunter story lately. But, you know, you never can go wrong with a good Cad Bane story. I remember at Celebration, Dave Filoni and Pablo Hidalgo did a panel, and I'm going to butcher the name of it. It was something like From, you know, Beginnings to Unexpected Fates or Finale or something like that. But it was about a lot of different animated characters that came up in Clone Wars and Rebels. And the big surprise from that was they had a clip from an unfinished episode of the Clone Wars where it was a showdown between Boba Fett and Cad Bane. Mm-hmm. And it was this whole thing. Cad Bane was, you kind of got the vibe from the description they gave us and this brief clip that they showed, that Cad Bane had always kind of wanted to test himself against Jango to see really who the best bounty hunter in the galaxy was. So he kind of took Boba Fett under his wing for a bit. And Boba Fett finally shows up in the Mandalorian armor after all of his other appearances in Clone Wars.
Yeah.
And they have their own little shootout at the OK Corral. And there was some themes going on there where it was Boba Fett really had this whole morality thing going on, and honor, defending an honor and doing things for an honor. You know, he could do a bounty, but it needs to make sure he's doing it with accordance of some honor system. Whereas Cad Bane was really doing it from the, I care about one thing. He'd get along with Han Solo in this way, you know, me, you know, it's, you know, he's looking out for himself. You know, the conclusion of which I don't think it's on any line anywhere. So, I'm not sure I can really spoil it. Sure, I don't know if you can actually still find it these days, but you know, they essentially shoot each other and they both fall over. What happened to them? You know, we all know Boba Fett survived after that. You know, whether that was Cad Bane's demise is hard to say. But anyway, it was a fascinating look at that. So if we were to see, you know, what kind of bounty hunter story would we like to see now? You know, like I said earlier, we haven't seen the First Order use them yet, but, you know, for the most part, other than, you know, Bazine's brief appearance. And, you know, then, you know, do we, you know, how do we see them fitting in with the First Order?
Wow.
Hmm. That's a really good question, too. I almost think somewhat, you know, even though Phasma was obviously part of the First Order, she was kind of like their little bounty hunter as well. They would send her out to take care of people and do things. And, yeah, you know, she was kind of like the thug, so to speak. But yeah, I'm not really sure what direction they'll take this.
Well, you know, it's funny because I almost feel like, Dennis, the shift, there's a shift here, right? Like, I feel like the First Order would not rely on bounty hunters because they're really super elitist. You know what I mean? Like, mm-hmm. We're the First Order, you know? And I almost feel like the Resistance, and thus the Rebellion, would be more who would utilize bounty hunters for information, for tracking, for anything like that. Again, it's more like a private investigator role, you know, to me, you know?
Yeah, I guess I understand what you're saying. I'm not sure that the Resistance would hire bounty hunters for that as much as they might hire... Yeah, the bounty hunters seem to be a very distinct thing. And I think there's probably a mercenary type that fits into what you're talking about.
Sure,
there that
would okay. be
different from the bounty hunter that maybe the Resistance would look to before then. I don't know. Maybe I'm splitting hairs, but the Resistance seems to have a certain idealism about them right now, especially now that their numbers have been pared down so much. I mean, you know, I can't see Poe hiring a bounty hunter. I can't see, General Organa doing that. Now that's not to say, you know, if you look back at, you know, their ancestry in the Rebellion, someone like General Draven or Cassian Andor wouldn't be above doing such a right. thing. Mm-hmm. But I just don't, to me, it's not necessarily a Resistance thing. I don't know. I've just been kind of fascinated because we've always had bounty hunters. It's just kind of been a generational thing. And we just really don't have a strong presence there yet for the First Order. So I don't know. I don't have an answer for that one. I would think, you know, perhaps at some point, maybe now that Snoke is gone, the First Order has kind of been this shadowy thing in the background fighting a Cold War with Resistance that, you know, how would the First Order go about hiring a bounty hunter? It might be worth more trouble than it's worth.
Yeah.
But now that they are conquering the galaxy with the Resistance crushed and the seat of government for the Republic demolished, you know, that might be of something of value to them.
Well, I think the closest thing we've seen to a bounty hunter in the new movies besides Bazine is DJ.
Interesting.
Being independent, you mean?
Yeah, and hired. Going mm-hmm. for the who's got the most credits, you know?
Yeah, but I think, you know, I get what you're going.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the, see what you're saying, you know, but he, you know, he had that recent comic, DJ's Most Wanted, and he labels himself a slicer. You know, this is a, you know,
sure.
they share some characteristics. You know, I was talking about Cad Bane's abilities with infiltration, you know, earlier. And that's what DJ did for Finn and Rose, is he got them aboard the Supremacy. But it's not, he's not going to, you know, and while he betrayed Finn and Rose, he wasn't hired out to track them down and bring them in.
But I'm just saying there's some like if we were going to Venn diagram this, there's some common characteristics between all these people who operate in the fringes, sort of like the bounty hunters, you know?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I guess that's what I'm saying. It's like, even though we don't necessarily have a specific designation of that's a bounty hunter, we still have kind of that feeling that this person is sort of in that world, in that element, in the, what was it? 1138? The whole series they were talking about, the underworld thing.
1313.
Oh, that's it. Thank you. And hey, and guess what? Well, you know, I was just scratching at straws there because my memory wasn't there. But you know, it's, and hey, guess what? Maybe that's going to be one of the series that we see on, you know, Star Wars TV, just saying. So we might get a little bit more bounty hunter love, but I just feel like the whole criminal element, or not even criminal, it's more fringy, you know what I mean? Hired gun kind of feel.
But it is criminal taxes, because, I mean, who was the biggest employer of them outside of Darth Vader? It was Jabba the Hutt. Mm-hmm. You know, that's right. You know, that's where Boba Fett took Han when Vader was done with him. You know, that's, you know, Bausch, when Leia was posing as bounty hunter, brought Chewbacca to Jabba the Hutt. And that's just kind of the contradiction there. You know, the Empire.
Yes, yes.
In some ways, you know, they put up with the Hutts. I mean, the Hutts had their own space, and I always felt like if the Empire had survived past Return of the Jedi, you know, they may have wiped the Hutts out eventually.
at some point.
But that's another conversation for another day. But, you know, those are the people that are hiring bounty hunters. It's the Empire, and it's this criminal underworld. And so it's just kind of a, you know, it's just an interesting contradiction to Star Wars that you would have the organization that holds itself out being the champions of law and order, dun, dun, as you like to say, and then the polar opposite of that, the organized crime of the galaxy, you know, hiring the same people to do things. So, well, do either of you have any final thoughts about bounty hunters before we wrap up this conversation?
Not really. It will be interesting to see, though, how the landscape of this characterization changes as we move forward, because it is kind of a neat little thing within Star Wars that I think everyone appreciates to some extent, some more than others, but we'll see.
Yeah, I might just say that despite prior opinions, occasionally we might need their scum.
Alrighty. Well, my final thought on is that I think there's a real potential for us to see some bounty hunters in Solo. We didn't get those in Rogue One. We didn't get those in Force Awakens or The Last Jedi. So I didn't realize that I kind of missed them in their role in Star Wars. So I am hoping we get to see some of them in the next edition of the Star Wars canon.
Sure.
It's time for
Silence, Fools!
So I previewed that our conversation this week was going to be about bounty hunters and put a call out on Twitter for some thoughts that maybe some of our listeners had. Mm-hmm. And Steven from Roku Depot chimed in. He said, I've loved the bounty hunters in Star Wars since the first time I saw them in The Empire Strikes Back. Greedo and A New Hope never had much of an effect on me. Yeah. I can see. Yeah. Seeing Bossk, Zuckuss, Boba Fett, Forlom, and IG-88 up there on the bridge captured my interest, as they were such a wild looking bunch of creatures, droid and character designs. Yeah. When I finally got the old Essential Guide to Characters book, one of the first things I did was look up the bounty hunters and read their backstories. When I finally got into the old EU books, I devoured all the short stories on them. Of them all, Zuckuss was my favorite. Mostly, I love the visual design, but his backstory was interesting. He often partnered with Forlom and had an ability to meditate and find his targets. This led to Forlom wanting to learn and meditate. Sadly, we haven't gotten any Zuckuss or Forlom in the new canon material. Boss has gotten lots of attention, and Dengar and IG-88 have all gotten attention, but Zuckuss and Forlom always get left out.
Yeah.
Hasbro didn't even make a Black Series figure for Zuckuss and Forlom. Maybe someday they'll get some love. And that's Steven from Roku Depot. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he's right. And honestly, I feel like it's only a matter of time, because I really think that with the Solo movie coming out, we're likely to see more focus on the Hutts, more focus on the bounty hunters, more focus on other smugglers and people that are in this underworld. I think we're about to get more of those stories.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, just how crazy would that be for them to go back and explore a little bit more of those two characters? I mean, that just speaks to the depth and the detail of the world that you're thrown into with Star Wars, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we see all these characters there, and they've all got these stories, but you know what? To tell the story of The Empire Strikes Back, we didn't need to know them, but that just left us wanting to know more about it. I mean, yeah, that would be awesome. That would be so great to see something like that.
Yeah. Well, I remember the tale, I think it was Tales of the Bounty Hunter book that he's referencing there with Zuckuss and Forlom. They kind of had a story about each one of them, and some of them revolved around the pursuit of Han Solo. And Zuckuss was doing that, meditating, trying to figure out where Han Solo was or where the rebellion was. And he's like, up. And it's because the rebellion fleet was like kind of above the plane of the galaxy. Hmm. And that stands out in my memory. Fortunately, I can't really remember the rest of the story. But
wasn't Zuckuss, wasn't he his species or his race like kind of force sensitive? And that's why he could mend it. Remember. I mean, I'm just thinking off the top of my head, but that's interesting that a droid would want to, because Forlom was a droid, right? And right. He would want to try to take on meditation. That's weird.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Well, last week we discussed potential light side additions to Battlefront 2. Then we each proposed a dark side character to add to the game. Taxus, you suggested General Veers. Jay, you offered up Darth Bane. And my suggestion was Cad Bane.
Okay. So I need to go on notice as protesting the results of this poll, but go ahead.
All right. We can get to that in a second. But I put those options up on Twitter as a poll to see what our listeners thought. And here are the results. So I added those three options and then an other, and asked for, if you're voting other, what your suggestion would be in the comments. Well, we got 12% of 51 votes for other. However, only Ryder Waldron suggested anyone, and that was Savage Opress, which, hey, good thought. I like that idea.
Yeah.
Coming in third place was Tax's suggestion of General Veers. Hmm. And then coming in second place was Jay, your suggestion of Darth Bane with 25%. And then Cad Bane came in first with 41%. Hmm. So lay it on us, Taxus. What is your protest here?
Well, I'm just going to say that the other, because they didn't necessarily identify anybody, should just automatically default to be General Veers as the officer. And I'm just saying, obviously the voters did not consider the high level of intellectual thought that I had put into my suggestion of a character in the last episode. So maybe if they go back and rethink it, then the results are going to be significantly different. I demand a recount.
Okay. And the answer comes out to 51 votes, 41% for Cad Bane, 25% for Darth Bane, 22% for General Veers, 12% other. Wow. It's funny how quickly I did that. But,
Yes.
All right. Well, that was fun. And based off the success of that poll, I am going to do another one.
Uh-oh.
Since we talked about bounty hunters this week, I'm going to ask you each, which bounty hunter would you least like to find out is hunting you down? I'm going to take a suggestion from each one of you, and then I'll add one to it, and we'll put that up on Twitter after this episode goes live. So, Jay, who are you most afraid of getting a contract out on you?
Well, I hope I don't take anybody else's answer here. I'm going to say Bossk. He kind of freaks me out. He's really, really tall, and that Trandoshan look and is just very intimidating. And I think he'd step on my toes, and that would hurt. But Bossk. Yes.
Okay. Interesting. Okay.
Taxus.
At first, I would think Dengar, because I'd be afraid of getting some weird disease, but I'm going to say IG-88, because nothing kind of weirds me out more than a droid that has a singular purpose.
I like it. I am tempted to go with Chonath Cha, which may not be familiar to a lot of people. She's a new bounty hunter that was added to the canon in the Lando miniseries.
Oh, and yes.
This was the bounty hunter that the Emperor called in. She's on Palpatine speed dial. So she was impressive there. So
very.
But that being said, after having talked about Cad Bane and having just won our last Twitter poll with him, I'm going to go with Cad Bane again. So.
Oh, I'm going to pre-protest my post-protest with this next one. So,
all right. And I don't know. I almost feel like we have to include Boba Fett by default as a fourth option, but I can only do fourth option. So we're going to do other. So all you that are going to root for or vote for Boba or Jango or Chonath Cha, you'll have to write them in.
That's your write-in candidate. Yep.
Yep, so that will do it for this week's edition of Silence Fools. Well, I don't know about the two of you, but I thought this was a really fun way to start our Road to Solo discussions. So before we go, do either of you have anything coming up for the Scoundrels to look forward to?
Well, things are kind of quiet on the Western front right now for me, but I've got some things in the works. But you can always find my blogs and my fashion reviews for Core World's Couture, my column for Coffee with Kenobi on coffeewithkenobi.com.
Yeah, and you can find me over in Assembly of Geeks with The Geek Supreme with Scott Murray and Jeff McGee and Regina Davis. And it's a little game show style geek news and review. So go check it out. Drops every Tuesday.
All right. Well, as usual, I have some recent comic reviews on Retro's app, including DJ Most Wanted number 1, which I highly recommend. I think I'm kind of in the minority on that one, but I love that story.
Huh.
And then Dr. Aphra number 16, which was good, but I'm a little concerned about the direction of the series.
Huh.
And you can find out why when you read my review. You can find all my reviews under the comic commentary section on Retro's app. You can also find me on Warp Trails, the Star Trek Discovery podcast that I do with my wife, Beth. Warp Trails is exclusive to the RetroZap podcast feed, which you can find on your favorite podcatcher under RetroZap, or head over to RetroZap.com. So, Scoundrels, thanks for listening and for your support. If you've enjoyed the show, this has been Starship, Sabers, and Scoundrels, and we would love and we need your iTunes reviews. So please head over there and take care of that if you could. Remember, you can write a podcast review directly from Apple's podcast app now, so it's easier than ever to leave a review. On the other hand, if you didn't care for this, please don't shoot us with the Camino Saber Dart. Those hurt.
Yeah.
Anyway, we do appreciate any time you share a show post with on Twitter and Facebook. Please let others know you're listening by sharing the show on social media. Thanks to everyone that has taken the time to share our show with others.
Sabernart. Sorry, I had to say that. And we are on social media. Starship, Sabers, and Scoundrels can be followed on Twitter and Instagram at @SQedPod and liked on Facebook, where we are facebook.com/SQedPod. If you want to follow Darth Taxus on Twitter, he is at Darth Taxus. Dennis is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. In addition to social media, you can reach us by email at sqpod@retrozap.com. We would love to hear your thoughts on the Solo trailers, but if you have anything else that is on your mind, Star Wars related or not, then let us know. Emails, really good tweets, and iTunes reviews end up in Silence Fools. Again, our email address is sqpod@retrozap.com.
As always, we are honored to be part of retrozap.com's podcast network. Did you know that RetroZap is home to 21 podcasts? I mean, that's like more than the number of bounty hunters that are after me right now. Please check out RetroZap for other great shows, including Beltway Banthas, Dork Lair, Scarlet Velocity, Techno Retro Dads, and We Know Nothing. Also, be sure to check out our Scoundrels t-shirts on tpublic.com. Just go to tpublic.com/user/sqpod, or just search for us on the site. This Valentine's Day, candy is dandy, but a shirt don't hurt.
Ha ha.
Ha ha, very clever. Thanks to Aaron Lay for our show logos, and to James Volpe, the Sky Geek, for the good, the bad, and the ugly show logo. And a very special thanks this week to Tim McMahon, Jay Shepard, Bill Janowski, and Sophie and Phil from Bright Tree Radio for the participation in our Valentine's Day messages.
Yes.
And here is our disclaimer. Starship, Sabers, and Scoundrels is not endorsed, affiliated with, or sponsored by Lucasfilm Limited and or Disney. This show is intended for entertainment and informational purposes only. All characters, music, and sounds are the intellectual property of their respective copyright holders. All else is the intellectual property of Starship, Sabers, and Scoundrels, unless otherwise indicated.
It's that time. Any final thoughts?
So, do you think the Lady Taxus will get you anything?
Oh, yeah, she already mailed me something.
A nice card?
No, another arrest warrant.
Then a bump. Well, that'll do it for episode 48 of Starship, Sabers, and Scoundrels. As always, thanks for listening and joining us this week. Until next time, may the Force be with you.
We don't need that scum.
Yes, sir.
Those rebels won't escape us. underground.